My name is Cecilia Dantnack, and this poem is called Autumn. I can't spell autumn or Wednesday, and I'm almost in college. I still count on my fingers for math problems, and everyone says I've grown, but I feel like a 10-year-old in an 18-year-old's body. If I could talk to myself 10 years ago, I don't know what I'd say. At 8, a picture of someone who hadn't seen what the world was, someone with hope never ending, and with dreams as big as Poseidon's sea. The scars that cover me are nowhere to be seen. At 8, I would have had a million questions for an 18-year-old me. From small questions like my favorite color to big questions about a future that I still don't know yet, a future that I have not the faintest clue of. Hopeful at 8, jaded at 18, filled with trust issues and trauma buried so deep that it is unrecognizable. Seeing the glass as empty, never full, I long for a world as an 8-year-old when you're free as a pack of wolves in the wild. Where climbing trees in the forest was how you proved yourself, and jumping in leaf piles, creating bigger ones. Or so excited for hot summers with a $3 ice cream bar offered on the hottest of summer days. If I was 18, I'd say to my 8-year-old self, stay true.
My name is Peter Fournier, and this is my poem, Memories of a Cave. I'm a caveman painting future messages across the walls, but the future people don't know what it's saying, and to be honest, neither do I. When he holds my face, I can't tell what he's saying, and I want to scream. I need to run because I know they're coming after me, but instead I squeeze into him. I'm theorizing on cave people, prehistoric men I fell in love with, stick figures in red chasing beautiful creatures stampeding through the stone. I want to hold his face and tell him it'll be okay. You'll kill the creature and save your family. But when I gaze into his eyes, he speaks another language and squeezes me too tight. I'm fixated on these caves a time before, and I'm fixated on grief, that you tried to tell me something and I couldn't tell what you were trying to say. I want to take care of you. I want to hold you. I want to love you. Let me drink you in. Let me be sitting in a field wondering. I know you. Like I have known no other, I have dug my fingers into a well of your blood and dragged a hand across my face. You love so much, so simple it hurts. My chest is caving in like you're standing on my ribs, and I can smell your voice when you lean down, hear the tears as they soak my shoulder. I can't even ask you why you cry for such a simple man. What's hurting you? To you, it sounds like nothing, like I'm nothing. I paint a self-portrait in your blood, in your home. The rain washes it away, so history forgets me. We still don't know how to draw ourselves. We use the other beings to disguise our true minds. I press my forehead to the caveman's. I'll take care of you. I promise. I am you, he says.
Hello, my name is Nina Mellitz, and today I will be reading my poem named It Wasn't That Bad, Was It? I remember the late night phone calls, holding in a laugh to not wake up anyone, clenching my jaw as hard as possible, smiling until my jaw felt numb. But it was the good pain, until it turned into bad pain, wondering how it got to this, blaming myself. You tore open my chest. You grabbed my heart and soul with your bare hands. Cold, scrawny fingers ached to my soul. Bright red dripping down to my toes, creating a puddle. I grasped onto the one thing I needed most, until you tore it up like it was a piece of paper. Pieces of flesh falling gracefully, and all was left was this big, dark hole. A circular, deep hole in the middle of my body, and the bitter taste of my blood. You took my heart, and you took it with you, the bright red standing right next to you, and you threw it away, leaving me with nothing, like it was some garbage. The black plastic bin devoured the bright red. Is that really what you thought of me? I laid on the squeaky bed, like a piece of garbage, because that's what I was to you. But why did she want to go back? Why did she want to go back to you? That thought pained her the most. That if you came running back, she would take you in a heartbeat, like a mother with her kids. Then they would take other parts of her body, bright red all over the floor. She was left with nothing, not even her body. Who was she even more? I knew I would be stuck like this forever.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Nora Fox, and I'm going to be reading my poem, Alone on a Train. Trying to sleep on a train, the background noise of train horns, announcements, and the quiet sounds of the wheels moving. The room is black, and in this moment, I am the only one awake. Thinking about anything, dreaming about the city I'm going to, looking out the window at all the cities we're passing. To me, they are nameless and unimportant. In this moment, I am tired, but my mind is awake, with ideas and questions and memories that make me whole. Although I'm passing towns filled with people, with lives and jobs and families, I am the only one around. Although I am traveling with my family, with their own thoughts and feelings and minds, I am the only one alive, passing through meaningless places to get to my destination. There are other people on this train, going to their own places, in states, cities, towns, with their own goals and purposes, but those are not real right now. In this train, I am alone, yet I'm surrounded by people who feel the same way.
A grown man on the train breaks his heart to me. Says I remind him of his daughter. Finished high school with a boyfriend he doesn't approve of, but who loved her more than anything. She moved to Las Vegas years ago, but he still talks about her like she's six. I'm a reminder of who she didn't turn out to be, and of who he lost. He tells me I remind him of his daughter, then turns around and asks if I want to fuck. An erasure of his regularly scheduled stranger confessional and the way my shirt rides up over my jeans. A pretty little lady as long as I'm 18, and don't acknowledge the front to my gender identity. He says I remind him of his daughter. Double buns how she got the nickname Mouse. But all I hear is a tattered breath of a voice drowned out by the bustle of people who make a point to look away. He touches my knee. Fingertips still slick from the oily lunch tucked into his jacket pocket, just above the rhythmic thumping bound to give out before he's 60. Carcinogens cracking bones into narrow splinters of marrow. A miscommunication. Fear looks like indifference to the privilege of never having felt that fear in the first place. He says I remind him of his daughter. Clinging to his side, a comfort object with scraping, rasping lungs. I see his tongue, pressing against the wall of his cheek. She becomes a bride, with red lipstick stains on her teeth. He says I remind him of his daughter. Loneliness seeping through lewd promises from the man who was left behind. A comfort object reworked and replaced by a signature and a stamp of permission, if not approval. The loneliness of seeing the train as the only way to be around other people. The therapy session from a high schooler who does not say anything, but accepts the role of his long, dead daughter.
Hi, my name is Maddie Williams, and this poem is called Golden. Boys will be boys and girls will be gold, handcrafted to be prettier than their mothers, kinder than their brothers, and skinnier than their best friends. Pushed to the point of breaking but not allowed to shatter, forced to hide the red matter that comes when time hits the clock. Have to bear grown men when they gawk at their gold, shiny from the looks of it but soft with a bite. Real gold knows how to sink to the bottom and not drown, held down by their fathers, shown off at parties like a new car. You can sit by it, but don't touch. Girls know too much about the world at a young age, but are dumbed down to a Playboy magazine page, told their body is the wage to get through life. Because girls are gold, born to be handed off at a wedding, born to bear the new generation of sculptors to mold the gold. Women are less shiny when they get old, becoming less vibrant, making men so violent they beat and murder, giving a man a chance to make a documentary. And it seems like men hate girls so much they can't even let them be funny, can't even let them earn the same amount of money, but love them so much they won't let them go. Men go crazy like Van Gogh, chopping off their wife's ear so she can't hear the incessant sound of his infidelity. But she can't hold jealousy in her golden heart. Men love girls so much women stay virgins, shave their legs, and talk in a high voice. Girls mature faster than boys. Do you truly believe that? Or do you just need a reason to like little girls? Or do you just like shiny things? Shiny sheer, tiny lace, beautiful face, short skirt, growth spurt, cherry cake, tough break, tough skin, cut up knees, smack to the face, warm embrace, seems like love to me. Boys are mean, but girls are gold. Hunted, stolen, pawned, and sold. Girls are gold. Bright, beautiful, prized possessions. Girls are gold. A family heirloom. Girls are gold. Sinking, sinking, sunk.
Hello, my name is Nina Mellitz, and today I will be reading my poem named Unrealistic Realities. She gazed at herself in distraught, salty flavored tears rolling down her cheek and creating an ocean beside her. She had too much extra skin on her body, crying because she didn't look like the woman on the magazine. She squeezed her stomach so hard it felt like pins and needles, staring at the glass smear, picking at her body, wondering what she'd look like if she was just skinnier. So she picked on herself, picked off her skin, when all was left was her hard white bones. She looked at the glass mirror in front of her, staring at her skeleton in hatred. But isn't this what she wanted? To be skinny? She finally looked like the girl in the magazine. Now that she is skinny, it terrifies her what she did to herself. Lost herself in the making, lost her family, lost her dignity, lost her mind. All she wanted was to be a size zero. Being a size zero meant you were pretty. Her mind floated away and her body disappeared. Painful screaming noises came from her mom. It broke the glass mirror. She laid in the pitch black casket, dressed in silk. Everyone said how pretty she looked, how that dress made her look good. But isn't this what she wanted? To be pretty? Thank you.
Hi, my name is Nora Fox, and I'm going to be reading my poem, Happy. I remember all the vacations, rolling through the ocean, laughing in the train stations, running down the little green hills, thinking, we're so much more than family. We're best friends. Thinking, I'm so happy right now. What could be better than this? Thinking, this is my favorite part of life. You are my favorite part of life. Over and over, I thought those things. Those beautiful, colorful feelings I couldn't even name. They were too big to be defined by one word. Even when you weren't around, you were in my mind more than ever. I was nostalgic thinking of our memories and excited thinking of what was to come. Until one day, you decided it was over. You didn't talk to me, barely acknowledged me, and that was it. I wish there was more. I wish there was some heartbreaking story, some big fight. At least then I would know why my favorite friendship ended. But there isn't one. You just outgrew me. Now I dread those vacations, knowing I'll have to see you and try and find small words to replace the big ones I wish I could say. I stress over embarrassing myself trying to talk to you. I live for those little moments where we laugh over something small. I memorize those interactions and never let them go. I can write every word you've said to me in the last year on a post-it, but the last 10 could fill an ocean, bigger than the ones we used to roll in, covering train tracks longer than the ones we used to laugh by, and so much longer than the little hills we used to run down. Running, laughing, happy.
Hi, my name's Maddie Williams, and this poem is titled The Lying Truth of the World. We buy matter until it doesn't matter, and we spend and spend. It's okay, though, because there will always be more trees to make the money. Unless we cut them all down, like my split ends. Snip, snip. Down goes the green. Green like the tea I'm sipping. Scalding hot. Burn my tongue. I don't use it much anyways. My lips stay shut. I stay quiet. I don't want to embarrass myself. Embarrass, embark on a road trip across the sky. They say a bird is a man's best friend. Take your best friends and drown in the clouds to heaven with God. The God? God? She? Not really sure what's up there. It doesn't matter. God said love your neighbor, but my neighbors complained about the noise when I played the harmonica too loud. Or maybe it was a soap opera. The one where they find out that the son has killed the dad. Things aren't always what they seem, because when I said goodbye, it wasn't good. I gave you a brisk hug. I didn't give my nose time to remember your perfume. I didn't give my lips time to say something that mattered. I didn't give my eyes a chance to start to rain. I said a quick see you later, but it doesn't matter. I stare down at my feet. They're webbed like a duck. Bad luck. I should have won that Oscar. Meryl Streep has a closet full of those little golden men. Why are they naked? Why do they always make statues naked? I need to have a talk with Michelangelo about that. What's his number again? 77. What's so lucky about sevens? I knew somebody who looked like the number 7. His name was 1. 1 looks like a 7. Correction, looked. 1 is now 100 and looks like a 2 because his back is bent. Sisters, let's pray that when we get old, our backs won't bend. Like a question mark. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, here comes the bride dressed in orange. Welcome her to the show. No eating in the library, ma'am. Do people who drink skim milk skim their pages? The whole milk people must be smart. I still don't know Michelangelo's number. Maybe I could call Master Splinter, but I'm afraid of rats. Thank you.
My name is Peter Fournier, and this is my poem, Memories of the Time That Wasn't. I'm self-diagnosing myself with shame and self-hatred driven by vanity. Painting myself ugly to feel pretty. The noise is exhausting. I've always wanted so much, too much from you, but somehow it was never enough. You gave me your all in all the ways I didn't concern myself with, and all the holes in me I fixated on were the ones you left empty. I slept in your bed even at 16 because I've never dreamt a day in my life, crying at midnight, bloodstains fresh in my mind. And in my head, I'm crying and rocking back and forth. I grab your face and ask you, why do you love the faceless boy? He tells you nothing of importance about himself, but you claim to know him. He talks so much, yet says nothing of note. And yet you claim to care for him. He's so private, yet you sometimes tell him facts about himself he never even told you. And when I ask you all of this, you, the amalgamation of every being I ever knew, you hold my face and you say, I know you. I love you. I love you despite knowing you. Take care of me, I cry in my mind. Take care of me. But really, we are sitting in a blank room, and I am still rocking back and forth as it's just a thing I do, but I don't cry. And you continue to look right at me and past me as I play my role in the worst performance the world has ever borne witness to. I exist to be consumed, a product, crafted by and for the people I know and will know. Everything seen in me is untrue. I condemn the liars as the biggest liar of all. I wax poetic about the joys of life and the hardships like I'm a real human being. But in my mind, I'm a machine built in the image of humanity, an alien from a race so dissimilar I could never be understood, a creature of no emotion until I do feel something in panic, until someone sees me feel something and I feel strangered. Everyone asks to know me, but I don't want to be known. I've never claimed to want to be known, and I will never claim to want to be known. What I want is to know others. Those dead and gone, those who never existed, those who are taking up my space, and those who are using up my brain. All the words I want to say are trapped in my chest until I break them into palatable poetry. Something to say, I have revealed myself, I am honest, and no one can call me on such an honest lie. Because when I'm done, even I am left to wonder, was I ever even lying in the first place?
I wrote this poem to find joy in my identity. In this name I chose for no one but me. I chose the name Ocean because I wanted to be the largest thing I could see. I wanted to be the skipping foam dancing on the edge of the waves to form and dissipate, always changing, never the same. No amount of societal pressure can force the ocean to change the tides, to strip back its layers until the starfish bake in the sun. I chose the name ocean because I wanted to be something powerful, but not cruel. I wanted to be a home to the people so lost the crashing of waves against rocks looks like an embrace. The salt stinging their throat, the closest thing to a kiss they will experience. Soft against their chapped lips. I wanted the people who I love and who love me back, take parts of me home and bring me into their art, squeeze me from their hair and onto the page. I chose the name ocean because it tore my sister from the shore, wrapped her in sand scraped bruises, and gave her back a breathing present. But it can still cup a child in its waves, gentle lapping against the rocks, the storm, a long distant memory. Do not think of me as a shipwreck, a storm-tossed piece of wood lost and confused. I may not know where I'm going, but I know where I am, at home, where the water turns the color of a fresh bruise moments after the sun dips below the horizon. But I'm still learning to love the days when names puff up the rain clouds and assign me the role of Atlas, a basket of weights pressing into my skin, but at least I chose this. At least I get to say who and when. A promise of confidentiality I don't know if I can keep. I chose the name Ocean because for the first time I feel at home in my identity, surrounding myself with a community who knows me. I chose the name Ocean because of all the memories. And that is joy enough for me.
Hello, my name is Hassam Zafar, and the title of my poem is Yellow Fruit. If lemons were free, they'd fall from trees on top of the head of Newton. If lemons were free, life won't supply them. Only when something is valued can it be gifted. If lemons were free, and so was affection, I'd have both. When I looked at my reflection. If lemons were free, they'd be with me 24/7. If lemons were free, lemonade would be freedom, with the citrus yellow fruit spreading its wings as much as a heathen. If lemons were free, I'd be on my knees, picking them up from the orchard, with people around me who are also there for the free lemons. If lemons were free, there would be an abundance of them. As far as the eye could see, there will be lemons. If lemons were free, which they are not, then we'd be in peace, security, and liberty with the saints and sinners holding hands in the lot. If lemons were free, which they should be, they'd be with me, my people, my friends, and every family. When life gives you lemons, you make lemonade. When life gives me lemons, I want to return them to life. Lemons, lemonade, sugars, sweets, and yellow fruit. If lemons were free, we won't have them. Lemons would be free, as they would be their own lemons.
Take it in.